Anybody else?
He also said if you let one sin stop you from having joy, you might as well let all your sin.
There you go. You let one, you might as well let them all. Anybody else? All right.
You want more? Because I have more.
If you have one, lay it out there.
So when you lose hope, it attacks everything.
What?
When you lose hope, it attacks everything.
All right, let's move on in peace. God offers the fruit of the Spirit, peace. It's the third one. Now, what can we say about the first three? It's in your book. Meaning what?
Inside of myself? Working on the inside.
Love, joy, peace. Working on the inside. First three. Love, joy, peace. You can't gauge by looking at someone necessarily whether they have or they are engaged in or working the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, and peace. Because they're not necessarily an outward thing. Now, of course, we know that love does because that love comes out. But when God's working the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, and peace in their life, He's working on the inside of us, trying to change, transform the way that we're thinking and acting and feeling. And the one we're looking at tonight, peace, has a lot to do with that. To be safe from harm in your spirit, mind, and body. In your spirit, mind, and body. To be safe from harm. Definition of peace, to be safe from harm in the spirit, mind, and body. Now, number two there says, those who live godly will suffer persecution. Now, don't ever let Satan, and I think, who was it? Well, Mitchie talked about having the Word of God inside of you. You have authority of the Word of God. But when we start using words and thinking of ourselves in the light of being godly. Somebody says, oh no, don't consider me to be godly. Well, you are godly. Because God lives inside of you. So don't let Satan come bringing that junk that says, it's just like being called righteous. We are righteous. If we trusted Christ as our Savior, His blood has made us righteous in God's sight. So don't let Satan come to you and say, oh, godly, you're pumping yourself up to be something you're not. Who thinks you're righteous? Well, I think I'm godly, and I think I'm righteous because of the authority of the Holy Spirit of God's Word living inside me. So when He says those who live godly, that's all of us. They're trying to live according to God's direction and will for our lives. And we get that direction and that will from the Holy Spirit communicating to us from God through His Word. The reading, the preaching, the teaching, our own devotion. And so when we live godly, which is what we are doing, if we are born again believers, the Bible says, we will suffer persecution. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life. This is Paul talking to Timothy. Purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions and afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch and at Iconium, at Lystra, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ shall suffer persecution. So, let's talk a little bit about this persecution and this peace that we want. We want to be peaceful, right? We want to get along with everybody. We don't want to run around with fear of being harmed in our body. As far as that goes, the aspect that most of us here are, I would say, are probably pretty peaceful about that. Being harmed in our body. Now, I know at different times we have been. Maybe you've been in circumstances where you were feared for your life, bodily, physically. But by and large, most of us here are pretty much okay with that. But then when we talk about our mind and spirit, those are some different areas there. Some different avenues, so to speak. So let's think about just a minute about what persecution and how persecution affects our feeling of safety in our spirit. Now, Paul talked about persecution, and he, in fact, all of these verses that are right in your lesson are Paul's writing talking about persecution. Remember, the Bible says that all who live godly will suffer persecution. Now, that word persecution, I think, is misunderstood many times. Even by Christians, it's misunderstood. When somebody says persecution to us, first thing we think about is Fox's Book of Martyrs and all those people that have died or been burned at the stake for the name of Christ. That is persecution. Plenty of it. Physical persecution. But what we have to understand is when God said you will suffer persecution, Satan tricks us into going around saying, oh, well, I ain't got no persecution yet. It may be coming someday, and it may be here. And I'm not suffering any persecution right now. Wrong. If you're living godly, you're suffering persecution. That word is misunderstood. Persecution is a relentless, means it don't stop. It's relentless harassment and annoyance, constantly, every day, all the time, coming against us, annoying, interrupting our daily life, bringing about harassment in our life. We suffer persecution continually, but we think of that form of persecution coming from other people. Now, we know, take China, for instance. We know as a fact that there are places in China where people are being killed, physically murdered, for their stand for Christ. And it's not just China. It's other places in the world. We don't face that in the United States of America. Praise the Lord. Thank God. We still live in a free country. But there are places where that physical persecution takes place. And we think that, when somebody says persecution, we think that's what we think. That one day they're going to come drag me out of my house and burn me at the stake in the street. And that is persecution. But that relentless harassment, that relentless, never-stopping, continual resistance that we come against in living our Christian life every day comes from Satan himself. Continually. He is always at the door. The Bible said in 1 Peter, he's like a lion roaming the streets out there seeking whom he may devour. So when we think about persecution, we need to put aside that thought of only that physical persecution. And by the way, we need to pray for people that are in places in the world that are persecuted physically. We do. We need to pray for them. And I hope that's part of your daily prayer, however you work your daily prayer time in working in those people that face that persecution. But it's a relentless subjection to harassment and annoyance and or even suffering. So Paul said that we'll all suffer persecution. We understand that Satan brings it to us every day, every way. And let's talk a little bit about what Paul said. Now, Paul talked about this persecution in Antioch. Antioch was a place north of Jerusalem, which is the first place that there was a Christian church was established outside the city of Jerusalem. And Paul went there on one of his missionary journeys. And notice what it says. Everywhere Paul went, first thing he did was he went into a synagogue to start preaching and teaching about Jesus. And if it wasn't in the synagogue or the church, that's what the Jewish word or the church, the synagogue, it would be in someone's house where they'd be having. And everywhere he went, that's what he did. And the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy. And notice what they said. And spake against those things which were spoken by Paul. Spake against those things which were spoken by Paul. Have you ever had somebody refute or argue with you about something you said about Jesus or about church or about the Bible?
Yeah.
That's persecution. When you are standing, Michelle, on the authority of God's word within you and you know that and you portray that and you expel that thought and put that thought out there, and somebody comes against it and pushes back against that and wants to argue. I think I told y'all a few weeks back, I mean, I've got a good friend of mine, a pastor friend of mine, that's been engaged in a Facebook argument with this guy for months. I mean for months. About Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, where it talks about assembling together. That's persecution. When you have God's word and you share that and you use that and you try to live by that and you expound on those principles, and somebody comes back to you and pushes back and argues, that's persecution. That's verbal persecution. Satan brings it to us every day, Pharisees, the Sadducees, that religion community that was so adamant to get rid of Paul because he was preaching Jesus. He said they spake against those things which were spoken by Paul. So that's a form of persecution, verbal persecution. And that's probably the one that we experience the most. It's probably the one we experience the most, that verbal persecution. But that's persecution. And Satan brings it to us every day. So how do we be safe from that verbal persecution? Well, I used to say, talk with the hand, but the heart ain't listening. You know, that's kind of being kind of sarcastic. But you don't have to engage in that conversation. You don't have to argue with people. You can pull yourself away. The Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs that if you take the wood off the fire, fire will go away. If there's contention and strife, just remove the fuel. Okay. Don't argue with me. I know what God's Word says. You choose not to believe that. Let's just move on to another topic. You know, there's two things you don't ever talk about around Thanksgiving table, right? Religion and politics. And in the South, it's football. But religion and politics. Well, folks will argue with you about it. Both of them. So, Paul faced that verbal persecution. So then he left there and he went on and he goes somewhere else. He took himself out of that conversation. I'm not going to be a part of that. I'm not going to be a part of that argument anymore. That verbal persecution. He goes on to Iconium. This is another small town where the church is established. Notice what it said. He talked about going into Iconium. He went into the synagogue and he began to preach and teach. And then there was also a multitude of the Jews and the Greeks that people began to believe. Not just that it wasn't just we're going down to hear the revival preacher. They began to put their faith in and trust in what the revival preacher was talking about. They began to trust Jesus. Jews and Greeks there in Iconium. And notice what it said. A whole number, a multitude of, but the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and made their minds evil affected against the brethren. They stirred up their mind in order to begin to run around out there on the outside edges of the crowd. You don't believe that, do you? You don't actually think what he's talking about to be true, do you? What does he do? We call it today, a lot of you may have heard the word sedition. That's when someone is involved in a movement, or we think about it particularly in politics, involved in a movement, and they begin to come in. And that's how it takes place in governments in small countries where the government is fixed to be overthrown. People begin to move throughout the citizenry of that country and begin to just cause people to have doubt. That's what the Jews and the Greeks, that's what this multitude of unbelieving Jews did. They begin to go amongst the people that put doubt in their mind. Boy, where do we know that from? Who is the world's A number one doubt maker? Satan is. Remember what he told Eve? Hath not God saved you? Mm-hmm. What did that do? It immediately put that seed of doubt in there. So he faced that verbal persecution there in Antioch. And then when he went down to Iconium and he began preaching, people began to get saved, turn their hearts over to Christ. Satan began to spread that doubt and used in Jews amongst us, turn to speaking, said they made their minds evil affected against the brethren. So there they turned that into another form of persecution. We call it ostracize. You ever been to a lunch table at work in the break room and start talking about Jesus, and all of a sudden you look around it and you're sitting there talking to Jesus? You bite yourself. Why? Because they didn't want to hear. They got up, moved away. They left you all alone. You were excluded from the group. And you walked up to the coffee pot, everybody walked away. So he went there and he seen that in Iconium. People began to be saved, and people began to try to push them away and set them aside and say, you don't believe that, you don't need to be a part of that. And so it goes on down a little further there in Acts, and it talks about, and when there was an assault made both of the Gentiles and the Jews with their rulers to use them despitefully and to stone them, they were aware. Now they were threatened by physical violence. So now they've had that verbal persecution, and we'll face that every single day, every single place. And then they were ostracized, and doubt was cast in amongst them because Satan bringing up that. And then they even threatened them. We're going to stone you. You don't show shut up, we're going to stone you. We're going to run you out of town, beat you up, whatever the case might be. So they went from that verbal persecution, that more intense verbal and that spread of the doubt, and now here they are threatened with physical persecution. But what does Paul keep doing? He keeps preaching right on. In fact, he leaves from Iconium and goes on to another little city called Lystra. And there came hither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium. Now look what's happening. They followed him. You know, they followed him. He was trying to get on and go preach somewhere else. What? Them troublemakers from Iconium and Antioch, they followed him. Who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he'd been dead. When that's reached that ultimate persecution, that physical persecution, they stoned him. And drug him outside the city walls and left him for dead. So he's gone through all these different stages of persecution. But look at what it said. Howbeit, as the disciples stood round about him, we got to go see about a profile. Finally shut him up. They finally done what they wanted to do. They killed him. And they're standing there with him. And what does he do? He wasn't dead. He got up. He said, howbeit as the disciples stood around about him, he rose up and came into the city. He went right back. He went right back. What does that teach us about our faith and our diligence and our consistency and our faithfulness? What sometimes makes me feel about this talk? Somebody fling a verbal assault in my direction, I tuck my tail between my legs and run like a scared puppy. Mm-hmm. You know, need to grow back. Need to get the authority of the Word of God settled in our heart. That's what the whole purpose of memorizing scriptures and reforming. It's not because it's some boring, tedious work, mental pencil whipping. No, it's so that you can have the Word of God, the authority, deep inside. So when the persecution comes, you can withstand it. You withstand it. What did Jesus tell Satan? Get thee behind me. So Paul went from that verbal to that threat of violence to the violence, and he got up and he keeps going. And this is Paul's exhortation to those who experience persecution. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding. Somebody might have been watching Paul out there and they drug him outside the city and said, well, I guess he finally got it, didn't he? I guess he finally realized they don't want to hear that. I guess he finally, he settled, he's done with. And then they watched as he rose up and walked right back into the city. What did he have? He had the peace of God. That peace to know that no matter what Satan brings to me, whether it be physical, in my mind, or in my spirit, and by the way, Satan, get in our mind. He'll get in our mind. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 tells us, chapter 5 tells us to cast down every imagination, everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. All that authority of the scripture that we have inside will Satan get in our mind and twist it around. You know the old Chinese proverb, you can't stop the bird from flying over your head, but you can stop them from making a nest up. So sometimes these thoughts are going to come. How many times have you ever just, that's like seemingly out of the blue, you had a memory from your other life? You know what? Back when you wasn't righteous, when you wasn't godly, when you wasn't living for God. What happens to that thought? If you let it, it'll park right there. Satan wanted to draw it to you because you can rest assured. If there's any memory of our former life, any memory of any sin that God has forgiven us of, it ain't God to bring it to us, it's Satan to bring it to us. And he's going to bring it, and he's going to plant it there. So that's why I said we've got to cast down, we just throw down, toss away every image or every imagination. You know, once you get an image, once you see something, you can't unsee it. You ever heard that before? Yeah, you can't unsee it. It's like, I was told, and I don't know, I'm not a biologist or a neurophysicist or anything like that, see an image or capture an image in your brain, it causes another part of your brain to get a little wrinkle to it. You know, the head of your brain may be all wrinkled. I guess that's why it's all wrinkled up. What I'm trying to make is, once that image gets there, we have to do something with it. We can't let it stay there. We've got to cast it down. And against everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, Satan says, no, you're not saved. Look how you're living. God says, you are saved. I see you through the blood of Christ. You're righteous in my sight. We have to come word for word with it. We've got to cast down that thought. We've got to get it out of there. So Paul said, the peace of God, which passes all understanding. I've been doing what I do in ministry for over 20 years and RU for 15 years. And sometimes people say, why? How do you just keep on and keep on and keep on and keep on? Gone through a couple of very tumultuous times when I felt persecution was coming at me personally, at the program and as a whole. And I just go to bed and I lay my head down on the pillow, go to sleep. Why? Because I'm some kind of superhuman. I got it all nailed out. No. The peace of God, which passes all understanding. Now, sometimes we'll say, that means that people look at our lives and don't understand why it's so peaceful. That's not all that means. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, comes about our understanding. God, how can I be peaceful in this time? I don't understand that. But it's His peace. It's His stability. It's His authority. His spirit inside of you. Shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. But we often prefer the work of the flesh. Word, any word warts in here? Word warts. But you know the truth of the matter is, most of the time, you know what it is. We worry about things we have no control over.
That's right.
None whatsoever. And if you've placed your life in the hands of Jesus, in God's hands, and trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, guess what? You don't have control over your life. Don't worry about it. It's up to God. It's His. Take care. But we often prefer the work of the flesh of worry. The definition of worry is to live in fear of having harm in your spirit, mind, and body. I ain't scared of nothing. I ain't scared. Are you scared of anything? Are you afraid of anything? Are you frightened by anything? Sometimes we are. Physically we may be. Some folks are frightened, scared of the dark. Some folks are scared of thunderstorm. Some people are scared of and you fill in the blank, whatever you're scared of. We're not talking about that kind of fear. I'm scared of spiders. Yeah. Make me squeal and run like a little girl with spiders.
Amen.
You know? But I have the peace of God in my heart. I'm not in fear of my spirit, my mind, my body. It's God's. It's in His hands. Now, if He wants to throw a spider on me every now and then, that's okay. He likes to play a little joke and scare me, see me squeal like a girl and run. He's okay. He can do that. But I'm not worried. I don't worry about what Satan's going to do. I don't worry about the end of the world. I don't worry about what's going to happen a month from now, or a year from now, or 6 years from now. That's all God's plan. I trust Him. I trust Him in my life for eternity. Certainly I can trust Him with my day-to-day existence and be peaceful. There's nothing like being peace. Some people love turmoil. Some people love to fight, argue, always be in a turmoil, always be not me. I'm a peacenik. I may be a hippie. Peace. I love peace, but I love the peace of God in my heart that protects me and gives me that confidence to go with it. Because I know Satan's going to bring it. He's relentless. He's relentless. I know He's going to bring it. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank You for a few minutes to talk about this idea of the fruit of the Spirit, peace in our life. Lord, I know that even here in this room tonight, there may be those who have that fear in their heart or their mind. And Lord, I know that if they trusted Christ as their Savior, that You can replace that. You can wash it away. You can move it aside and just let them have that peace, that confidence that comes in knowing that You're in control, You're in charge, and there's no need me fretting and worrying about something I have no control over. Because God, You're in control. You're in control of everything. And the sooner I realize that and recognize that, the quicker I can have that peace that passes all understanding. Not just that other people don't understand, but that I don't always understand. How to be so peaceful and so calm. Just all the Christ Jesus. I'm thankful for that. I pray You help me. who may have that thought there, who may have that worry, to cast it aside. Cast their burdens on you, as you tell us to do there in the book of 1 Peter. To cast them on you, put them on you, not worry. Lord, I pray for peace, and I pray for understanding, I pray for guidance. I just pray that you work in our hearts.